China is the ultimate tiger economy, with the fastest rate of economic growth of any major nation. The country is second only to the United States as the largest economy on Earth. But recent figures show China's rapid expansion has begun to slow down. So what does that mean for the new leaders in Beijing, for the Chinese people, and for economies around the globe? Hello and welcome to this special edition of Propeller TV's Business World. I'm Jin Wei, and in today's program, we will be looking at China's economic transformation, the challenges it presents, and the Chinese government's plans to introduce a major period of restructuring and reform. I will also be bringing you news of exciting partnership between Propeller and TVE for this year's Global Sustainability Film Awards, videos designed to change the way the world does business. China is a country of impressive statistics. In the past 3 decades, the economy has doubled in size every 8 years. It is the largest manufacturing economy, the largest exporter, and the second largest importer of goods in the world. But China's rise as an economic superpower has come at a cost. With greater inequality, rural poverty, and widespread environmental damage caused by rapid industrialization, now it seems the pace of expansion is slowing. But before we focus on how the Beijing government is responding, we will start by looking at the state of the world's economy.
While China pursues a period of economic restructuring, a global transformation in the light of the international financial crisis is taking place. Firstly, as the representative of the Western countries, the United States is promoting the reindustrialization or remanufacturing to lessen the impact of the financial bubble and ease employment pressure. Secondly, parts of Europe that were once reliant on high welfare support have seen a period of benefit cuts to move towards a society where a more appropriate level of welfare is provided to ease the debt crisis. Thirdly, the economic and social development models have been restructured to reduce greenhouse gas emissions in a bid to ease global warming and make the transition to a low-carbon economy. And finally, industrial development has expanded to develop new, higher value-added industries. The green, low-carbon industry is an example of one such trend.
In the context of the global recession and China's own economic slowdown, Beijing's leaders have had to think of new ways to shape the nation's development. These changes will be the latest in the series of major reforms since the foundation of the People's Republic.
If we look back at the history of modern China since its founding in 1949, China has experienced a number of major changes. The first one promoted a socialist transformation, and the second, which began in 1978, now known as a period of reform and opening, transformed the system from a planned to a market economy.
And respect from an old Chinese man.
The nation state is now in the process of its third major transformation, one which is set to once again transform its economic development model.
To understand more about the current situation in China, the proposed reforms and their likely impact on the world economy, I went to the City of London to interview a leading expert on emerging markets.
Following the turbulent period related to European debt crisis, the prolonged weakness in Western economies, as well as the ongoing issue of quantitative easing policies in developed countries, the attention of the world markets has been steadily turning towards China, with special attention being paid to the Chinese government's policy measures relating to financial reforms. I spoke to Brian Corton, legal and general's emerging markets strategist, to analyze China's existing economic model and the challenges of bringing about the financial reform within the country.
Nice to see you, Brian. So my first question is, will China be the largest economy system in the future?
We think China will definitely get there. The last 20, 25 years, it's grown about 10% per year. The current expectation is that that's going to come down to about something around 7%. But even at that rate, China will overtake the US sometime between 2025, 2030. That's that sort of time horizon.
So why does China need to carry out the financial reforms?
We think the Chinese model has become too dependent on credit and too dependent on investment. We think the economy ought to move towards a more consumer-driven economy and one that has less leverage.
Moreover, Brian Corton analyzed the key existing problems within the current Chinese economic model.
When we look at the efficiency with which China is using savings and using capital, that has been deteriorating quite sharply since 2008. So we've seen a lot of projects have been approved, a lot of investment has happened, but it's not delivering the sort of growth that was previously delivered by the same amount of investment. So productivity growth is starting to slow down sharply now. As China's population gets older and the labor force grows less rapidly, productivity is going to become more and more important in order to secure strong growth. And at the moment, productivity performance is deteriorating.
China's real GDP growth rate in the first quarter of 2013 was 7.7%, which is the lowest rate since the start of the global financial crisis. Nevertheless, in the same period, newly added credit reached equivalent of $448 billion, with the average monthly increase of almost $1,500 billion, exceeding 2012's average of just over $1,100 billion. Furthermore, the scale of total social investment reached a monthly average of $350 billion, which represented a record quarterly increase. Additionally, after adjusting for seasonal factors, social funding is still up 22% year on year. Why is there a trend imbalance between China's economic growth and credit increase?
Obviously, there are big parts of the economy that aren't so focused on credit. Including the consumer sector doesn't tend to be credit driven. It's possible that there is just a time lag between a pickup in credit growth and a pickup in investment and GDP growth. So we might just have the loans are made, but they've not been used to finance the investment yet. So there could just be a time lag. It's possible that companies borrowed money in the beginning of the year, but were unsure about the direction of policy with the handover of power to the new state council, and so have sort of sat on the cash. We have seen deposit growth pick up in China, so there's all sorts of possibilities. But the other conclusion is just that the credit is being used less efficiently than it was in the past. The deteriorating efficiency with which credit and investment is being used is a problem that they need to address.
Furthermore, China's debt as a percentage of GDP is lower than in European countries, Japan and also the USA. In the year 2009 alone, the total debt of the USA was over 90% of GDP. However, isn't it important not to overlook the issue of China's debt
because of China's very different political system.
We don't think that the level of debt in the Chinese economy at this point is that concerning necessarily. It's high, but it's probably manageable. It's really how fast the debt has been increasing, which is the worry. When you see credit growth that rapid pace, you do have to worry about the quality of the investment decisions which have been taken. Well, the concern is that there's a lot more debt in the economy than there was before. So if the central bank has to put up interest rates, that's going to cause more problems for companies than was the case in the past in terms of servicing that debt. So you could get non-performing loans emerging in the banking system. The other issue, as I mentioned, is the quality of the investment decisions which have been taken have deteriorated. So you're not going to get the returns to the investment. It won't be as good because the investments have been done so quickly, and the decisions have not been as good in terms of allocating that capital. So it's negative for growth, and it increases the risk of financial instability.
China's level of investment as a proportion of GDP is extremely high. How should the Chinese development model be modified in the future?
We think investment will remain high in China as a share of GDP. It's currently 47% of GDP, which is very high historically. We would be concerned if that was to rise further. We think over the medium term that ratio needs to come down, because investment in China is very credit intensive. So if that ratio continues rising, we'd like to see credit and leverage continue to rise and increase those vulnerabilities that I've spoken about.
Well, nowadays, does the environmental question have a strong bearing on China's economic development?
I think it's one of the reasons the government wants lower growth, is that they see growth at 10% is going to, certainly manufacturing capex driven growth is going to be increasingly polluting. So this is one of the reasons they do want growth to slow down and to rebalance to more sort of service industries, you know, less heavy resource intense sectors. I also think it's important for the type of infrastructure investment that they're looking to spend money on. So, you know, cleaning up the water supply, improving pollution, you know, infrastructure investments in those areas, I think are going to have a very strong payoff.
Given the current economic challenges facing China, how successful does Frank Horton believe the Chinese government's reform will be?
We think the government needs to do three things. It needs to reform the economy to allow the private sector to grow more rapidly again. It needs to rebalance the sources of demand. So it needs to encourage the consumer, which has still got a very low level of leverage, a strong balance sheet. And the third thing it needs to do is to exercise some restraint in using credit and investment driven stimulus policies, which they've used since 2008 very aggressively. It needs to be restrained in doing that, doing much more of that. The government is already talking about having a more liberal exchange rate regime, a more liberal interest rate regime to allow them to get away from this system of trying to control the quantity of loans in the economy, which has caused problems, you know, the growth of shadow banking. So we think that will be quite important to allow interest rates to reflect the true cost of capital more effectively than has been the case until recently.
What is the likely international response to China's reforms?
The new government has set out the importance of reform quite clearly. That they've been very articulate on the need to do this. What we don't yet really have is a strong blueprint for exactly what they're going to do. But so far they've done a few things which have been encouraging. So we've seen the liberalisation of certain rules and regulations for private business. That's been quite important. There's been some liberalisation in the telecom sector. They're looking to improve the urban migration, the licensing system, the hukou system. So there are quite a lot of areas that they've started work on. I think people see, it's got to be difficult because these are sorts of changes that you don't really see the results from for a while. So I don't think expectations are that high in terms of what the government's actually going to deliver. People see that it's an economy that needs reforming and needs rebalancing. But people are not really sure, I don't think, in the West as to whether that will actually happen.
After that expert opinion on China's reforms from Brian Quarton, in part two of Business World, we will be analysing the policy of Beijing government with help of Roderick Wai, Associate Fellow of Chatham House. And there will be the news about a propeller's exciting partnership with the TVE Global Sustainability Film Awards. Please join me again after the break.
Traditionally dominated by Russia and America, space is a high-stakes aspiration where the risks are high. But so are the rewards. No longer the final frontier, we chart the story of China's race to space and bring the highlights from the Shenzhou missions to UK screens. From launch to landing, we'll tell the stories of the architects, the astronauts, the feats of engineering, and their experiments. Destination Mars. A season for Propeller TV charting China in space coming soon to Sky 189 and online.
You're watching Propeller TV.
Hello, this is Propeller TV. I am Chen Zhang. I am now at the Library of Birmingham. Around me are 800,000 books. This library will become the biggest in Europe and expect to be open on September the 3rd. Let's discover its innovation and benefit for the public in advance.
新伯明翰图书馆坐落于城市中央，总面积约为3.1万平方米，共10层楼。这座图书馆由荷兰著名设计师法兰钦霍本设计。外形犹如一个巨大的结婚蛋糕，透明玻璃墙幕上贴着大小不一的金属圈，阳光普照时，大大小小的圆圈影子便映照在床笼和书架上，与顶部的圆环吊灯相互照应。法兰先也称这个图书馆为人民的宫殿和城市会客厅。
But most of important that we wanted to create a kind of own from the inside.A new perspective on Birmingham with the beautiful shadows, and that you always feel in the building, yeah, surrounded as a coat from the inside. I know a lot of people now talk about the outside of the building, but the building was really designed from the inside. So the secret of the building is the inside.
横跨三层楼的环状书墙是图书馆内部设计的亮点之一，它由80多万本书组成。置身在这里，仿佛游走在书海里。与剧院和音乐厅的融合，使图书馆将文字和音乐世界连接。底楼的儿童图书馆也可根据不同需求而变化结构。整个图书馆的设计还获得了可持续发展和绿色环保认证。
The city wanted to make a BREEAM excellent building, and it is. It became. And this idea we had about the sequence of rotundas, what you see in here, is also.Part of the whole sustainability concept. Through this sequence of rotundas, we could create, together with Happelt, who is our consultant, a mixed mode ventilation system. We could bring in daylight in the middle of the building, and by stepping back the volumes, we could create these green terraces, the green gardens. I love the secret garden. to be on top of the building and just smell the herbs and see the flowers and see the soft hills around Birmingham.
除了新颖的建筑设计，图书馆藏书更是过百万余本，具有300年历史的图书就有8200本，其中包括被誉为世界上最贵的图书《美国鸟类》。在伯明翰图书馆拥有世界第二大的莎士比亚收藏，图书馆顶层建立的莎士比亚纪念馆藏有 4.3 万本各时期出版的莎士著作，最早的出版日期可追溯到1709年。伯明翰图书馆由市政厅拨款，花费1亿8800万英镑。然而面对科技的迅猛发展，人们口袋中的电子书和移动设备越来越方便使用，有人不禁会问，伯明翰为什么投入巨资建造图书馆呢？
Well, I think the city council is very far-sighted in that what they recognise and investing in the library is really a very tangible manifestation of that recognition. That the city of Birmingham needs to put learning and culture at the heart of what defines it in the 21st century. That a modern global city in the 21st century has to talk about learning and culture and not just about retail and transport infrastructure.It's got to be a good place to live.
面对科技和网络的冲击，布莱恩·甘布斯表示，图书馆和科技是相互推动和利用的。
On the digital side, we've really tried to flood the whole building with technology and make sure that the printed word and the digital word work together. We've got a very strong online presence. Increasingly, what we've invested in is technology for mobile applications. So we have a mobile app called Dozens and Trails, which you can access on your smartphone or on your tablet. We're trying to use different strategies to engage younger people with our collections.
对于图书馆的长期发展，布莱恩·甘布斯强调，他们希望能将平时忽略图书馆的人群吸引到这里，并且让每一位参观者都能找到喜欢这里的理由。而且，这里也不仅仅只是个图书馆。
What the library is doing is recognizing that through all of that, what people also need is a social space where they can interact with other people and use that for positive reasons like learning.Where we need to focus our attention is on how the public library can change people's lives and how we can empower people to understand their health, their learning opportunities. So it's about using those information resources to encourage people to learn and improve themselves.
回首伯明翰图书馆创建的过程，法兰辛·霍本也感慨万千。
Yeah, it's also for me an emotional moments because it's also saying goodbye and giving, like a child, you give the way to somebody else. But I will keep coming to Birmingham.
预计伯明翰图书馆今年将迎来300万左右参观者。除了实体图书借阅，图书馆所有藏书都可以在网上免费借阅。这里是浙江国际记者张成、马克从伦敦为您发回的报道。
It's an all-new look for Propeller TV with all news shows at 7 p.m. every night. Start a working week on Mondays with Business World, a digest of news, views and interviews from all studios in London and Beijing. On Tuesday, it's time for fun, fashion and frivolity with Lifestyler. Take a longer look at culturing or exclusive documentaries during Chinatown on Wednesdays. Get off the beaten track with all travel and opinion show passengers.And then chill for the weekend ahead on Fridays with our new music exchange show on the stage. All week every week, premiere shows on Propeller TV, weeknights at 7 p.m. on Sky 189 and online.
UK Lifestyler is Propeller TV's fun time TV show.
It is dedicated to lifestyle and entertainment.
We have covered everything from fashion design to music, food and dancing.
Join us on Tuesday at 7 and put some style in your life.
At Propeller TV, Sky 189 and online.
We'll come back to the part two of this Business World special on the rapid development of China's economy, the challenges this presents, and the planned response to the recent economic slowdown. Earlier this year, in one of his first major speeches since becoming Chinese president, Xi Jinping addressed the Boa Forum and outlined the key areas of the program of reform and restructuring.
Let's look at the six main points of President Xi's agenda. On the economy. On international relations. On national income. On reform. On regional cooperation. And on trade.
I'm joined now in the studio by Roderick Wai of the world-renowned think tank on international affairs, Chatham House, who will help us to understand the implications of President Xi's proposed reform. Welcome, Roderick, and thank you for coming on to Business World. So can we ask the question which is about what is happening to China's economy and what are the problems that President Xi needs to address?
Well, what we have seen in China is 30 years of extraordinary economic development at a speed that has been unprecedented anywhere. And this has been a huge success in many ways for China. But I think we are coming a bit to the end of that, as it were, first stage of China's development, that much of the impetus of the economic model that drove China to its success, import, export-led economic growth, is coming to an end. And there have been, in recent months, a number of questions as to whether or not the Chinese economy is running out of steam that have, from time to time, caused huge concern in the markets and internationally. It now appears that China perhaps isn't running out of steam and that the economic development will continue. But it does raise real questions about the necessity for China to maintain very high rates of economic growth, because what China really needs is sustainable economic growth, not necessarily high-speed economic growth. And part of what I think the new leadership need to do is to find a more appropriate path towards a sustainable development. Part of that, I think, will be a rebalancing of the economy, rebalancing it more towards consumer-led impetuses for the economic growth. But part of it will also be a big new way of looking at the problems of China's economic development.
So how crucial is it that China improves its economy links with other countries, both for China itself and the global economy?
Well, one of the extraordinary things of China's development over the last 30 years has been its integration into the world economy. But China was very separate in many ways from the world economy when it started its economic growth and reform. Now it is an integral part of the economy, of the global economy. And it needs to maintain that because it needs to maintain its access to global markets, both for selling Chinese goods and equally for obtaining raw materials, energy, and other things crucial to China's continuing economic progress.
So is that, you know, target to double the income of China's citizen by 2020 overambitious?
I'm always a bit sceptical about sort of numerical targets like that. The numbers are always susceptible to manipulation. But the point, I think, is that China is committed to substantially increasing the living standards of its people in the next 10 years. And also, I think, important for China will not be simply the overall numbers of GDP per capita, but it will be how that income is distributed among the Chinese people.
And the next question I would like to know, are the government's actions since the speech in line with President Xi's state commitment to reform and opening up?
It depends on what side of the sort of reformist argument you are. What we have seen in recent months, is a continuation, by and large, of the policies that Xi Jinping inherited. There were huge expectations when the new leadership came into power that we would see a major new reform initiative. So far, that has not become apparent. It is still unclear quite the extent to which the new leadership is committed to fundamental reform in China. So we are still at an early stage, I think.
So what size have there been of closer regional cooperations between China and its neighbour?
Well, China is very committed to improving its economic relations with its neighbours. It has, in particular, signed a number of free trade agreements with ASEAN, with other countries in the region. And I think these are as much political as commercial documents, indicating China's commitment to developing and progressing its economic and commercial relationship with its neighbours. So I think this is a long-term strategy for China. It is not a big change coming from Xi Jinping. He is just sort of reiterating existing Chinese policy. I think that while the economic relationship with China's neighbours has improved significantly, what we have seen in the last year or so is some problems on the political and strategic side, particularly with countries like Japan, where the relationship between China and Japan at the political level is very strained at the moment, and similarly over areas such as the South China Sea, where China has had problems with a number of its Southeast Asian neighbours. But this has not really affected the overall improvement in economic relations.
Cool. And I'm quite curious, why is there pressure on China to liberalize its trading relations with the rest of the world? And what did Xi Jinping mean by increased facilitation?
I think there is always pressure on almost any country, both to open its markets wider, and certainly there is a lot of concern that China should open some of its internal markets more widely to foreign competition, that it should in particular pay more attention to the protection of intellectual property rights for foreign companies doing business in China, that it should help and support the wider international movements towards promoting and developing free trade. And I think these pressures will remain on China. What Xi Jinping means by facilitating is not exactly clear, but it is a commitment in principle to be that China is intending to be as helpful as it can in promoting international trade liberalisation.
So what do you think about, Chinese government is promoting RMB to be international currency at the moment?
I think that's a sort of long-term goal for the Chinese leadership. It would sort of put China on a par with the United States and the United States dollar, or with the European Union and the euro. And that is an important, I think, political goal to show how China has really and truly emerged onto the world stage. I think it is less important from an economic perspective that China's economic development, that China's economic reform and opening up can continue without the renminbi being a major international currency. But of course, for the UK, there is a lot of interest in helping China achieve that goal, because the UK is a major financial centre and hopes that a lot of business would accrue to the UK from supporting China in that venture.
So overall, how do you think about first the 6 months of Xi Jinping's presidency have gone, and is he delivering any policies he outlined in April?
I think Xi Jinping and the Chinese leadership are in a uniquely lucky position in politics, in that they are likely to hold their positions for the next 10 years. So in many ways, they are not in any great hurry to implement their new programs. So I don't really expect, and I haven't really seen, any big changes in the last 6 months. When Xi Jinping made his speech to the Party Congress. He promised in particular that China would take real steps against corruption. And we are seeing some serious steps being taken. We're seeing a major party rectification being undertaken. We are seeing big steps being taken to sort of improve, if you like, the governance of China. So I think that is one important element of Mr. Xi's programme. What we haven't yet seen is substantial economic reform, although we are, this is part of an ongoing process, but we haven't seen any major new directions in economic reform. And in particular, we've seen, if anything, a sort of rowing back on ideas of political reform in China.
I would like to know, what's the difference between the third reform and the last two reforms?
Well, first of all, I don't think that we necessarily know quite what the third set of reforms in China is. From my own perspective, I think one of the really important things that China needs to engage in going forward is the development of innovation and its intellectual talent. I think China is facing unprecedented new problems and needs to find new solutions to these. It's not just China, of course, it's the world as a whole that faces these new problems. But one of the sort of key factors in all this will be how China manages to continue with its process of economic reform and economic development. But I think it will need to be in new ways. So I think innovation, scientific, technological, intellectual innovation is really one of the key elements of China's third wave of reform.
So next, the question I would like to ask you, what signs are there to indicate the future direction of China next 10 years of Xi Jinping's leadership?
I think that's what sort of commentators are puzzling over at the moment, and not just commentators, policymakers, because what China does in the next 10 years will inevitably have a huge effect, not only on China, but on the international community as a whole. We have seen in the past 5 years China's growing influence following the international financial crisis, China's importance at that time as one of the sort of major drivers for continued world economic growth. China will continue to be in that sort of position over the next 10 years. So what people will be looking for, I think, is two big things. One is how China manages its own domestic transition processes, how China copes with the demands of modernization, how China copes with all the problems that are attendant upon that, like environmental pressures, like demographic pressures, like political pressures for more involvement by the Chinese people in their own political futures. And on the international side, people will be looking very closely at how China engages with the rest of the world, how China uses its new power and influence in the world, and what sort of role China decides to take in the world. And these questions, I think, are still very much open. We know that China is a very important country. We know that for almost all the global problems that we face, there is a China dimension. But what we don't really know yet is what the China path, what path the Chinese leadership would like to take in the future.
Well, thank you, Roderick, for your insight into this very crucial issue. And now, that promised news about Propeller's partnership with the TVE Global Sustainability Film Awards, I met Rita Afrid, the awards organizer, to find out about this exciting initiative and began by asking what was the purpose of the competition.
Well, TVE initiated the Global Sustainability Film Awards last year as a way of really encouraging companies to look at the responsibility they have to the environment, to their local communities, and to show us what kind of innovative projects they have to make a change for the local community or the environment. And we were delighted last year that so many companies from around the world entered these awards.
What is the social responsibility?
Investing back in what has made you great. And it's really important for businesses to understand that you can't just carry on taking out of the environment, out of the public, out of, you know, sort of other businesses. You need to be able to reinvest.
What does TVE do to assist this?
Well, TVE is a company that was set up 29 years ago by the United Nations Environment Programme, the World Wildlife Fund, and Central Television, which is a television company in the UK. And the central remit for TVE was to make films that would inspire change. So we're delighted by the partnership that we have with Propeller TV. So not only will we be seen in across Europe, but we will also be broadcasting through Propeller in China itself.
As we know, social responsibility costs money. So who is paying for this?
Yes, it does cost money. But I think it's money well spent and well invested. And that's one of the you know, sort of things that we would want companies to be able to say and show that they have spent money on a community investment program, on an environmentally friendly product, but that actually they're gaining so much more from it.
Then how do people enter if they are interested in it?
We're looking for short, innovative, inspiring films, up to 10 minutes long. So they're very short films. And they can really be showing us anything that a company is doing. It could be that they are very active in their local community. So they're giving back to the local community from which they've developed. It could be that they are very, very hot on the environment and protecting the environment. Maybe they're an industrialist. And we would like to see what are the measures they're taking to protect the environment from which they are taking natural resources or whatever. The last category is the inspiring good governance. And that, I think, is really actually a very interesting category, because that's all about setting a good example, inspiring good governance, not only asking national governments and local governments to lead the way, but also getting corporates, getting small businesses, big businesses, to lead change and inspire people to do better.
Can you talk about some influence of these projects to all the participants and audience?
It puts you on a global stage. It allows corporate world leaders to see what you're doing, to be able to network, to be able to talk to each other, to be able to click up the press of a button. We want it ingrained into the next generation of world leaders, whether they're business leaders or global leaders, to be very much intrinsic to everything that they do. So it's a, you know, sort of it's an outwards approach.
So what do you think about China?
Everyone is interested in China. The whole world is interested in China. It's a massive, you know, sort of manufacturer for the whole of the world. So it's really important that China is involved in the debate, that we learn from what China is doing, and that China learns from what everybody else is doing. And that is why we really want to encourage Chinese businesses to come on board, get onto our website, take a look at what we're doing, take a look at the kind of films that you can enter, and get entering.
Why do you think China's rapidly growing economy and environmental protection is inversely developed to the trend?
Well, I think that if they don't do that, they would be making a big mistake, because, as you know, resources run out. You know, sort of Chinese businesses, like any other businesses, understand how important it is to be able to invest in their workforces, to train them so that they do a better job, to help them affiliate with their company so that they want to work for that company and they don't change. I mean, that way businesses save money. They save money, they make the world a safer place, and, you know, it's a win-win situation. So I can't understand why China wouldn't want to be part of the debate.
So if more and more Chinese company and the local governments, they intend to involve in those sustainable projects such as World Expo and the Global Sustainability Film Awards, will they have more and more, you know, like global competitors?
Well, I think they'll have international recognition. And I think that that's very important, that, you know, sort of businesses recognize that other businesses, other countries, are making an effort to do good. And that's very important. I mean, I don't think you can put a price on that price tag. So it's not a business price tag. But actually, the value of other countries recognizing that China wants, is very, very involved, wants to be involved in the sustainability debate, and is very, you know, understands that its impact on the environment as an emerging economy is central to what, you know, sort of Chinese leaders are thinking about, and it's central to their development.
This was the scene in London's BAFTA for last year's awards ceremony. Rita showed me around the venue.
So we are completely delighted that we are here in the David Lean Room, which is very famous because of a very famous British film director, after whom the name, the room is named. And as you can see, I mean, it's a lovely, lovely layout. Last year we had, it was fully booked, we had 160 guests, and it's a fantastic central location, yeah, with these beautiful windows that look out on, you know, sort of, we're in the heart of Piccadilly. So the awards ceremony takes place in this wonderful Princess Anne Theatre, and guests come in and sit down, and the winning films will be screened on the stage there. And last year it was wonderful because the whole of this theatre was filled with our guests, and it was just such a fantastic atmosphere in here to be able to have the winning films screened on the screen here. Everything was shown here, so the names of the companies who entered the films, the winners came up on those screens. We had this fantastic stage on which, you know, sort of winners were able to come from the first seats that were reserved for them, go up the steps and go to receive their rewards. You know, it's a great opportunity for companies to be able to show the rest of the world what they're doing.
And now you can have the chance to watch the last year's overall winner, which was made by Group Bimbo, the largest bakery group in the world. It illustrates the company's commitment to its staff, the local communities where it works around the globe, and the principle of social responsibility.
Creo que soy muy afortunada porque siento mucho apoyo, apoyo en el trabajo, apoyo con mi familia. Por ejemplo, en mi casa, pues a mis hijos les da mucho orgullo. Cuando platican a sus amigos, no, pues mi mamá trabaja en Bimbo, sí. ¿Y tu mamá qué hace? No, pues ventas. Maneja un camioncito, maneja un camioncito.
No buscamos nosotros que con el trato y todo esto haya mayor productividad, pero el resultado inevitable es que cuando la gente está satisfecha, da lo mejor de sí misma. Y se ha creado lo que mucha gente llama la cultura Bimbo, que permiten a la gente no solamente encontrar en la empresa la manera de ganarse la vida, sino también tener una contribución a su felicidad.
Yo no sé qué tiene este osito que está aquí, no sé qué tiene, pero se mete en el alma de todas las gentes que estamos en Bimbo. ¿Qué les pasa a la gente Bimbo que se enamora tanto de su empresa? pues lo que se da es que hay un trato justo, un trato humano, un trato, es decir, en donde pueden de alguna manera superarse, ayudarles a ser mejores personas, a ser mejores ciudadanos, a ser mejores padres de familia y a ser mejores trabajadores, ¿no?
Pues mis sueños, obviamente, crecer, ¿no? Y de hecho, esta es una empresa que nos deja crecer.
El Grupo Bimbo se fundó en el año de 1945. Fuimos cuatro socios originales, teníamos nada más 34 colaboradores, pero tuvimos la gran fortuna de que hubo de inmediato una gran aceptación del público.
El tema de la responsabilidad social no es un tema nuevo para nosotros y es una razón de ser nuestra. Estamos muy contentos con lo que venimos haciendo y particularmente con la última decisión de poder reconvertir en México a fuentes renovables todo el gasto de electricidad.
Y estamos dispuestos a apostar por este tipo de proyectos, no nada más por el beneficio financiero, sino también por el beneficio social y ambiental.
El proyecto de reducción de huella ambiental integra tres ejes fundamentales: reducción de huella de carbono, reducción de huella hídrica y manejo integral de residuos.
Queremos ser una empresa que le regrese más a la sociedad, que generación tras generación sea fuente de trabajo para nuestros colaboradores.
Y la familia, primero la familia, eso es muy importante en Bimbo.
Pues era trabajador.
Pues yo me fijé en sus ojos.
Muy decente.
Y también tenía un cuerpo bonito.
Que no eras tan guapo. Tengo muy buenos recuerdos de todos.
Don Lorenzo hacía mucho énfasis en la cuestión de perseguir los objetivos a través de metas. Pues es lo que ha regido mi vida, lo que yo aprendí en Bimbo.
A pesar de que fueron otras épocas, otros tiempos, como que van siendo ciclos, ¿no? Como que las cosas se van repitiendo. Cuando fue la reforestación, fue una experiencia muy, muy, ¿cómo decírtela? No tiene palabras. El ambiente, el campo abierto, los diferentes aromas, ¿no?
Muchas empresas hablan de sustentabilidad, pero muy pocas están vinculadas con los bosques. Entonces, gracias a Grupo Bimbo, estamos dando ejemplos que puedan ser fácilmente seguidos por las empresas del sector privado. Si logramos que las personas que viven en los bosques obtengan los mayores beneficios, las comunidades van a estar satisfechas, van a vivir con dignidad.
Aquí no hay empleo, la gente tiene que salir a la ciudad a trabajar, pero también ahora aquí, como ven ustedes, aquí hay invernaderos que ahora sí, más adelante, pues ya no van a tener que salir para ir a trabajar en la ciudad.
La comunidad en la que nos encontramos espera de nosotros que seamos buenos ciudadanos y tomar en cuenta las grandes causas nacionales, causas de la comunidad.
Agua es que nosotras como mujeres desarrollemos capacidades que también las mujeres sabemos y podemos.
Esta comunidad particularmente era una comunidad que ya no producía nada. Y ha habido un proceso muy importante de revertir el problema de la migración, ¿no? Cuando ves que es posible cambiar vidas, cuando ves que es posible cambiar realidades, realmente te convences, ¿no? Y más cuando ves que ha sido el esfuerzo de muchos actores, ¿no? Y que es posible. qué otro México, qué otra realidad, qué otro país es posible, ¿no?, con esta participación, pero que tenemos que sumarnos todos, ¿no?
Pues el trabajo que nosotros realizamos, pues no cualquiera lo puede hacer, ¿no? Y para mí es un orgullo y es de gran ayuda. ¿Por qué? Porque pues de ahí podemos sustentar a la familia.
Lo que tenemos aquí basta y sobra, y es muy importante trabajar para nosotros porque somos los dueños de nuestros tiempos, somos los dueños de los productos, y jamás, jamás hay que decir uno no vale la pena vivir. No, vale la pena de vivir porque ahí vamos a disfrutar, y solamente tenemos una sola vida, y los sueños puede haber mucho, pero a veces soñar y despertar y continuar y hacer lo que estamos soñando.
Para nosotros es muy importante asegurar que nuestros proveedores cumplan con los mejores estándares, sin importar el tamaño que tengan. En la empresa creemos que nuestra cadena de valor tiene un alto impacto.
Yo cuando empecé a correr, empecé a crecer. Dejé de fumar. El saber que puedes llevar tu cuerpo más allá de... Esa es la parte padre. Que puedes ir más allá de... Que te puedes exigir, que puedes decir, sí lo puedo hacer. Nada me va a detener.
Me dicen el Chicharito. Mi sueño es ser un gran futbolista.
No, pues ahora sí que gracias al futbolito Bimbo, mi hijo lo están reconociendo, porque sin ello, pues no, él no hubiera llegado hasta donde ahorita está.
Nuestra aspiración como empresa es a trascender. Por eso creemos que la responsabilidad social es parte intrínseca de la labor de las empresas. Y en ese sentido la concebimos hacia adentro, en la formación a nuestros colaboradores, y hacia afuera, en el impacto que tenemos en nuestras comunidades en donde participamos.
Finalmente, todo este reflexionar sobre la empresa, sobre sus finalidades, sobre su responsabilidad social en su máxima expresión, me recuerda una frase de Henri Bergson que decía: piensa como hombre de acción y actúa como hombre de pensamiento. Y yo creo que esto nos lleva a la necesidad de que el empresario sea alguien, no que sea un activista nada más, sino que reflexione, que vea las consecuencias de sus actos, que tenga ilusión en trascender.
Sí, soy muy feliz. Me siento muy afortunada, me agrada mucho mi trabajo.
Hola, hijo, se llega. Hola,
tía. Me siento muy orgullosa de trabajar en Bimbo.
So please log on to the TV website and see how your company or local authority can be part of this year's competition. We will be covering the awards night in London's BAFTA and showing the winning films on the channel. That's all from this edition of Business World. Thank you for watching, and do get in touch if you have comments on this topic or there is any other relevant subject that you would like us to consider investigating. Until next time you join us on Propeller TV Sky Channel 189 and online. It's goodbye from me and the whole Business World team. Goodbye, 再见.